Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Home economists tell you to make a meal plan, plan out your grocery trip, write everything down, go to the grocery store, and only buy what's on your list. That's not how I shop. That's not how I shop at all. I'm the kind of person that knows sort of in the back of my mind what my pantry staples are, the things that I always have in the cupboard. Things like barley and rice and the spices and, you know, there's always tomato paste, there's always cans of tomatoes, cans of beans, dried beans. Those sorts of things are always in my pantry. And I always have, you know, onions, carrots, and celery in the fridge, pretty much always. I'm the kind of person that rolls up to the grocery store and immediately goes back to the meat counter and sees what's on sale. And so I did that yesterday afternoon, and this outside round, it was cut as two steaks, was 50% off. Had a sticker on it, 50% off, made it cheaper than ground beef. So I looked at that and said, great, I'm going to make a soup. I'm going to make a soup, and I know in the back of my mind, I've got everything that I need to make a soup except for mushrooms. So I went over and I got some mushrooms. And so this is just something out of our pantry. And I think you need to sort of, if you're trying to save some money, I'm trying to save some money. I've got a little project on the go that, you know, is sucking up a bit of my money. You need to sort of be agile on your feet and look for those deals. So I've got this outside round. I've chopped it up into little cubes. I've put some oil in the bottom of this pan. I'm using grapeseed oil. And I've got it up on pretty high heat at this point. Didn't sizzle yet because it's not quite hot enough. But I've put all of the meat in the pan. There we go, a little bit of sizzle. So I'm gonna add some salt to that and some pepper. I've got this on the highest heat setting. And I'm gonna stir it around, I'm gonna brown it. I know that this goes against everything that we've ever been told about how to brown meat. You're supposed to do it in batches. Don't overcrowd the pot. You want to brown it, not steam it. Something that I have adhered to pretty much quite religiously. And then a couple of weeks ago, we did a recipe written by Paul Bocuse for beef bourguignon. And in that recipe, he says to put everything into the pan all at once and brown it for 30 minutes. And he uses an excess of oil. So I put a little bit of extra oil in the bottom. That was some of the best ground beef I've ever had. It built such an amazing flavor and an amazing fond on the bottom. Sort of turn away, don't really think too much about it, give it a stir, keep an eye on it. But that 30 minutes of browning was amazing. Now for alternates for this soup, ground beef, definitely ground beef you could use. Or any sort of stewing meat that's on sale. That beef bourguignon, I made it with something called beef rib finger meat, which is the meat between the ribs that's cut out in the processing plant. It was dirt cheap as well. And so that's the sort of thing, just look for those bargains. So, about a half an hour, we'll let this go and we'll see what happens. Okay, an incredible amount of browning on this beef. Look at that. Just incredible amount of browning. And the fond in the bottom of the pot is incredible too. Now at this point you need to assess how much fat is in the bottom of the pot. Just like any time you cook and you fry your brown beef at the beginning, or pork or anything like that, chicken for that matter. And I think I've got the right amount of fat in here for the soup that I'm looking to build, so I don't need to take any away and I don't need to add any. So I'm just gonna set the beef aside. We've got onion, carrot, and celery in those go. And we just want to soften them down. We don't really want to brown them. You just want to soften them and drive off most of the liquid. This is also an opportunity to start scraping up some of the fond that's on the bottom as they release their liquid. This soup doesn't have a deglazing step per se. You just kind of do it along the way and it works out really well. Next in is tomato paste, and I get questioned a lot about the amount of tomato paste I put in. Yes, I usually put too much or more than it calls for in the recipe. If it calls for a tablespoon of tomato paste, I'm usually putting in half a can. I really like the flavor the tomato paste brings to most things, and so I overuse it. And it is one of those ingredients that, realistically, you put into taste, like salt and pepper. If you don't like tomato paste as much, don't put as much in. If you really like it, like I do, definitely put some in. So I'm going to put that in now, and we're going to just sort of mess it around in the bottom of the pot. You kind of want to brown some of the sugars that are in the tomato paste, to make it sweeter or sort of bring that umami flavor from the tomatoes out a little bit more. I'm not really worried about cooking the tomato paste at this point. I mean, it is cooked. It was cooked when it was canned. It was cooked before it was canned. It's going to cook for an hour after I add all of the other ingredients. It's not that big of a deal. So that's about as much time as I'm going to spend on that. I've got thyme and summer savory. I'm going to put those in at this point. I have a bay leaf. I'm not going to put that in yet. If you can't find summer savory or it's not something that you can get where you live, don't worry about it. Leave it out. I really like what summer savory brings to soups and stews. But I do understand from the comments that it's not available everywhere. So don't worry about it too much. And if you want to put something else in, another flavor that you really like that goes with beef, maybe a little bit of rosemary, put that in. Really easy. Next in are some mushrooms, and I've got these sliced fairly fine. I'm going to put those in, and I'm going to fry this or continue frying this until they've released all of their moisture and most of it is driven off. Okay, this is looking really good. Now we come to the barley. Pearl barley is something that I always have in my cupboard. Sometimes it's pot barley, usually it's pearl barley. Doesn't really matter. If you don't have barley, I'm pretty sure you probably have rice or beans in your cupboard. Not dry beans in this case. I would put in a can of beans or canned beans, something that's already cooked. That's what I'd put in, or the rice, definitely. Or any other kind of pulse. You know, lentils would be great in here, and you don't have to cook those ahead of time. You can throw those in dry. Lentils would be fantastic in this. The point is, you don't have to be beholden to using the barley. Just use what you've got. Use what you have on hand. You don't have to make a special fuss about making sure that this recipe is made exactly the way I've written it out. Next in is Marmite. And my jar is almost empty. So I'm going to get a good scoop, or as much Marmite as I can get out of the bottom of this jar, which isn't very much. I'm going to put that in. It's a tough one for some people to get their head around the Marmite. And I do see a lot of comments where people have said, I hated Marmite, and then I started using it in my soups and stews because you sort of convinced me to do it, Glen. And now I think it's fantastic. And it is one of those things. So if you live in a Marmite country, use Marmite. If you live in a Vegemite country, use Vegemite. If you live in a Bovril country, use Bovril. And if you don't have access to any of those things, don't worry about it. The soup is going to be just fine. Next we come to the stock. Oh, a bay leaf. Don't forget the bay leaf. Next we come to the stock. This recipe needs about 8 cups of liquid. And I usually say 6 cups of stock and 2 cups of water. And so when I came home, I looked at what stock I had, and I didn't have enough chicken stock and I didn't have enough beef stock. So I've got a mix of chicken and beef stock in this jug, homemade. Not a huge deal to use homemade. If you use stuff out of a carton, go right ahead. Fantastic. There's some really good ones out there. Use them. If you don't have enough, I mean, you could substitute part of that liquid and use beer, lager, ale, or stout. A stout would be amazing in this. You've got a part bottle of red or white wine in your fridge. Use that as part of the liquid, definitely. You know, use what you think tastes good to you and put it in your soup. All of those things would work out really well. I wouldn't do all beer. I wouldn't do 8 cups of beer, and I wouldn't do 8 cups of wine. But, you know, part of it, definitely. So I'm just going to give this a bit of a stir. I'm going to bring this to a simmer, not a rolling boil, just a simmer. I'm going to put the lid on and let it go for about an hour, hour and a half. Okay, I think the soup is ready. Let's see. Looks really good. Looks really good. So, get a couple of scoops of soup.
Hey, hey Glen, I heard a couple scoops of soup. Hey, friends. Yep.
Get a spoon. No, that's not gonna. Okay, spoon.
That looks absolutely fabulous. There's lots of color. I see carrots and mushrooms and barley.
Barley, yep.
Can I dip one of these biscuits in it?
Nope, that's another video. There's an incredible depth of flavor there.
Yeah.
Like there's a lot going on and it's all really coming together.
No talking, just eating.
Mm-hmm.
There's a flavor I can't quite put my finger on though. Any thoughts on what it might be?
Well, there's thyme and summer savory, probably the summer savory.
It's the thyme, I think, that I wasn't expecting.
Okay.
Very good.
This is a very good soup. Okay, so this is a really good soup. And it can be a very inexpensive soup if you shop the sales for the beef. And if you don't want to buy the beef, ground beef would work just as well on this. And it would still be a really good, inexpensive soup. So, thanks for stopping by. See you again soon.